Good afternoon, everybody. Hi, and welcome to Vintage House, to our third installment of Active Aging, Live Your Best Life Now, in partnership with the Sonoma Valley Hospital. My name is Katie. I'm the program manager here at Vintage House, and I would like to invite you, when we're finished, to come to our table at the back, where you could see a little bit. We have some brochures and information about some of our programs and services, and we also have the hospital table over there. I believe there might be a few freebies. And if you would like some coffee, tea, or water, just right over here, we've got a table back there. So I'm going to introduce you now to Don Kuwahara, Chief Ancillary Officer from the Sonoma Valley Hospital. Thank you so much, Don.
Thank you. Oh. Hello, everyone, and welcome to our 8th annual Active Aging Series. And our goal is to help you live your best life now. Before I introduce our guest speaker, I would like to make some acknowledgments and some reminders. First, I want to thank our hosts, Vintage House and Sonoma Valley Hospital, and the staff that helped put this event on, Katie DeYoung from Vintage House and Celia Cruz de la Rosa from Sonoma Valley Hospital. I would also like to recognize KSVY Sonoma TV in the back there, and they are streaming and recording this event. So, I do have a few reminders. On your chairs, there are cards for you to jot down your questions. We will answer questions at the end of the event, and we'll collect them. We actually have two audiences here today, those of you who are in person and those of you who are watching remotely. So for those of you who are watching remotely, you use the chat to ask your questions. And reminders, please turn off your cell phones or silence them. And if you're watching virtually, turn off the mic. So now I would like to introduce Merrick. I have had the pleasure of working with him for 15 years. He is a highly skilled clinician, and what I appreciate is he uses humor and compassion when he's with his patients. And I know we have a couple of his patients in-house, so if you want to raise your hand, it's great to see you. A little bit about Merrick. He was born and raised in Poland. He received his master's degree in physical rehabilitation. And before joining Sonoma Valley Hospital, he completed his residency at Kaiser Rehabilitation Center, specializing in Vallejo, or I guess the center was in Vallejo, right, Merrick? Specializing in proprioceptive neuromuscular facilitation. I'm going to let Merrick explain that one to you. Merrick regularly works with Sonoma Valley patients to help them with balance issues and encourage a more active lifestyle, and is quick to advise, if you don't move, you rust. Let's give a big hand to Merrick Grispowski. Thank you.
Everybody hear me? Okay. Thank you very much for the introduction. Like, there was no pressure so far. TV, a lot of people. I went from pretty confident to not confident at all. But welcome, everybody. First impression, I'm a biggest failure in Sonoma County, because I'm pretty sure more than 50% of people here already heard what I said, and they came more. So that means I don't deliver the message, or the message is so good that they come for more. I'm trying to figure out where should I stand. Anyway, welcome. And what we're going to talk about today is a very simple thing. The title of today is walking, or beyond walking, and how to be joyful, and a lot of the other things that goes to it. So what I'm going to do, and this is how I prepared the speech, I'm going to bore you to death with technicality of walking should be. then I'm going to test you on it, and I'm going to tell you, go home and be joyful. And that pretty much summarizes the next hour of this presentation. So now, the big topic on the title is how to actively age. And I'm not an expert on aging yet, but I started noticing it takes me longer and longer to get out of the bed in the morning and do what I normally did faster and smoother and easier. The other observation that keeps coming is I got more and more people telling me, wait till you get older and then you're going to appreciate what you have right now. So it's kind of like there is a topic and tendency that everybody repeats, and we all struggle with trying to get the grip on how to handle that. So physical therapy and physical rehabilitation is mostly about movement and mostly about correcting movement. And now the biggest struggle I have as a physical therapist is actually not teaching the movement, but selling it to people that are coming in that they moving it in the wrong way. So we are not taught how to move. Most people are not lucky enough to have a professional coaching telling you how to bend over, how to squat, how to lift, how to walk. Nobody was taught how to walk, and if they were taught, they don't remember how to do this. They're talking about how to walk, let's hold your hand, let's go, and sooner or later, kid picks up and goes from that. Yeah? Nobody teaches us how to run. It's a natural thing. Everybody says this should be natural pattern. Yeah? And then we read statistics that, oh, natural runner, 60% of runners have a problem sooner or later, either foot, knee, back, or something. They get injured. And that's the statistics that was written in the 60s. And then they blame the shoes. So the shoes came in better. The orthotics came in. And you read statistics from 2020, and they say 60% of people get injured. Well, it wasn't the shoe, wasn't the orthotic. The same 60% keeps failing. So maybe there's a user problem, okay? And that's the same thing with walking. That's the same thing with exercises and everything else. So now, not to go to philosophy of it, but the joy, I look for definitions before I came in here. Joy is about happiness. Yeah? So nobody can define what makes you happy. Yeah? That's the same thing when it comes to health. Nobody can tell you what really health is. You could be sick like a dog, but be happy. You could be perfectly healthy, wealthy, and everything else, and you're not going to be happy. So this is the part where it's kind of hard to tell people how to fix their problem, but active aging is about trying to figure out where's the balance. And so from my perspective, as a movement specialist, I'm trying to figure out how to make things that are happening on a daily basis easier. Because nobody wants to work harder when they retire. They're retiring for a reason, yeah? You don't want to work. You want to retire. So if we're looking at simple act of moving and walking, yeah? So we go from doing chores because we're walking. Yeah, we have to get from point A to point B because that's life required. If you can't do this, that's already a source of unhappiness. Now, if that thing is painful, well, you're definitely not going to be happy. So how can we bridge the gap? How can we modify what we do in terms of making life easier and looking at exercising, looking at activity like walking in terms of making it better as opposed to letting it get worse and never come back again? Okay? So this is where the technicality comes. I remember my first year in physical therapy school, came in, the subject was called biomechanics, and the guy comes in and starts throwing slides on the board and says, walking is about swing phase, stance phase, it's deceleration, acceleration, the knee bends, the hip flexes, this goes. 15 minutes into the lecture, I'm looking out the window trying to figure out why am I here as opposed to doing something more fun. 2 hours later, I have a subject that calls kinesiotherapy, or in here people call it kinesiology, it's kind of, you can bridge that gap. It's about human movement and physical activity combined together. How can you alter? And a guy comes in and says, well, let's look at walking, and I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to go out the window because he's going to talk about exactly the same thing 3 hours later. But the guy says, well, think about walking. You lose your balance, you gain your balance. I'm like, oh, this guy's talking simple. So now I'm in a good path. I can stay in that school. I can do it for a living. So that's what I'm trying to sell people on the same thing. Don't look at your activity. Don't look at your exercise. It's a very sophisticated problem. Change your perspective on how you using your body as opposed to doing more of the same things. And then maybe you can find solutions to a lot of problems, yeah? So if we're looking at walking from the same definition that I learned on the first year in physical therapy, yeah, so I have to have my balance and I got to be able to afford to lose that balance and get from one step to the other in perpetuity. The easier I can make it, the farther I can go, the cheaper that walking is going to be. So somebody made the speculation that if you provide oxygen and food, people can walk forever because it's so cheap energetically. And so how come we got people that struggle getting from parking lot in here? Yeah, because somewhere in the process, you're forgetting about one of those two elements. You either forgetting how to hold your balance, or you're so afraid to lose that balance that you're holding at all costs not to go forward. Yeah, and now we got a conflict in the body. The body is starting to create some other patterns, as opposed to you falling into your walking, you start pulling yourself forward, you're trying to go as hard as you can, you're squeezing all different pieces and parts of the body. And at the end of your walk, as opposed to feeling joy, you feel pain, misery, and you don't want to do it again, okay? So, again, from my perspective, it's kind of easy to say fix it, but the bigger part in here is to bring to your attention what is the problem that you're actually making, yeah? Again, another anecdotal thing, I get a lot of patients that come in and say, We have the history to fill out. Everybody that comes into physical therapy, we ask them, what is the date of your injury? And I have always fun because I get a 75-year-old patient and he writes 1961. So, okay, you injured yourself in 1961. Good for you. Now, can you tell me, when does it hurt? How does it hurt? What do you do when it hurts? I don't know. So you had it since 1961 and you can't tell me anything about your problem. That is more common than you think. We get people coming in telling you that there is a problem, but they cannot point the finger in any direction that helps me to identify what the problem really is. Yeah, I don't know what you're feeling. I can't fix what I don't feel. I can see some stuff, but I may be fixing something that is not a problem. So unless we get the common grounds in the language and communication, I can't work with you because then it feels like I'm shoving my idea into your head and you might not necessarily like it. I was told I'm not the nicest person in the world, so that always brings some conflict, yeah? So think about it, as the aging happened, unavoidably, body changes, yeah? As the body changes, is perception of my body changing with me, or is my perception still like it used to be, yeah? If you close your eyes, don't tell me, how old are you in your head? Are you 40, 20? Some people go farther, 60, yeah? And driver's license is one thing, but in your head, you stuck 10, 15, 20 years earlier, yeah? We all have imaginary period in there that mismatches what the presentation of current body ability is, yeah? Some people have mental acuity different because it changes, yeah? But the idea here is not to pick on anybody. The idea is to have the reality check and do the graceful approach to life as opposed to trying to keep butt-headed with something, yeah? So as we're looking at movement, well, your movement has changed, but do you realize that it has changed? Or do you just perceiving the part that it's more difficult, yeah? So the part of activity in that aging is trying to strip apart and find out, okay, if I'm doing the same thing, yeah, so walking is a perfect example. I used to walk from my car to the next door neighbor and back and step over the curb and do 5 steps and do this and this and this. And this was easy. So what holds me today from doing the same thing and call it easy and joyful? Why can't I go for a walk with my dog for 4 blocks and I'm doing this one? And there's multiple reasons, yeah? I don't have stamina. My heart doesn't beat fast enough to catch up. I'm short of breath. My knees hurt. My back hurts. My legs are going numb. There's multiple reasons, multiple diagnoses for it. But do you know that that's the problem? Or you just say, oh, I'm tired and I'm done. Yeah? So identifying the problem that we have is number one thing in my book that makes it easier to deal with it. Yeah? If you don't know that you have a problem, you can't fix it. Now, if you know what kind of problem you have, it's much easier to fix it. Yeah, so we're going into that direction of can you feel how different your body moves? Yeah. The next example is, can you feel, can you control your own body parts? This is not an anatomy or physiology test, but can you put your hand on the front of the thigh? So let's do the exercise. Everybody, feet on the floor, flat, both hands on your thighs, on the front. Can you make the muscle under your hand contract? So contract means the muscle is squeezed and it changes the volume, yeah? Can you make your thigh work? Can you make left one work, right one work, left one work, right one work, yeah? So it's a simple exercise, you controlling your body. Now, anywhere in your body, put your finger on it or think about it, can you do the same thing, yeah? How can you change that, yeah? So this is the first part which comes with, okay, now I own my body, now I can start controlling it. So when I'm moving, can I choose which body part moves better, which body parts move less? Where do I produce the power from? How can I do that, yeah? And now there is better way to do it, and there's multiple ways of not doing it well, yeah? How many ways can I cheat for proper movement versus how many ways can I correct what's going on? So there's left side, right side, and center somewhere in there. Is it really the good strategy, yeah? So going back to walking, yeah? If I have the phase of controlling my balance, who in that line supposed to control my balance? Is it my neck and shoulders? Is it my lower back? Is it my knee, foot, and ankle? Or is it the biggest muscle in your body that distinguishes us from other animals that makes us walk up straight, yeah? So as you're looking at it, simple test. First of all, can you do that? Second of all, what is really that holds you up, yeah? If you can't do this and hold it, and statistics says 10 seconds is considered safe community ambulator, if you can't do it for 10 seconds, your risk of falling increases exponentially. So you're looking at it, okay, I got one simple test, I got the other simple test, and there's things that doesn't allow me to complete that test successfully. Well, can you identify what is the holdup, yeah? So the fact that you're losing your balance, that's already one. But two, am I losing that balance because I don't know what I'm trying to do? Am I losing that balance because I'm not using right tool for the job? Or is it, am I losing that balance because I'm doing everything right, I'm using right tool, but that tool is too weak, yeah? And now we're getting towards what is the solution to my problem. And now, as a physical therapist, I can give you solution. I can tell you, do exercise, X or Y and Z, yeah? So exercise is supposed to, again, I'm looking at definition of different words before I come in here. Exercise is supposed to be maintaining your health, your fitness, or boost your health and fitness, and for some people to bring them happiness. That was exactly how Wikipedia, I think, put it together, yeah? So again, if you know why you're doing certain thing, your chances of being successful at it are much higher, yeah? If you're walking because you like fresh air and that's the only way you can clean up your head, it doesn't matter how you walk, as long as you open the door, get out there for half an hour, come back, you lost all the stress out that somewhere in the neighborhood, you come back, you're happy. That's good. But if you're trying to walk to get your heartbeat better, well, it's going to be a little bit different walking. Now, if you're walking because you're trying to make your muscles work, well, you got to change the walking a little bit so you can actually control your muscles to walk. Make sense? So the same walking will be different for different person and different reason. Yeah? Cardiovascular, you need that interval work. You need to pick up the pace, slow down the pace, get your heart going so you get that boost that cardiologist says you need this, yeah? American Heart Association says you got to do it for 30 minutes once a day for 5 or 7 days a week at least to maintain your heart health, yeah? Walking is a good job to do it as long as you can do it for half an hour, yeah? So those are the things that we're looking at as a, yeah? What is the obstacle that prevents me from doing this, yeah? So now, the second part is, and they kind of always together, can I maintain that balance? So the balance is, again, okay, you identify the problem, you figure it out. So now let's strip even further. What allows me to do it right, yeah? So we know which tool is doing the job. The butt should be doing this. There's something on the opposite side that's supposed to hold it together because, again, Newton says the forces have to balance to stay in steady position. So now, if I'm doing this right, and I introduce fall, can I keep it in the same position? or in the process of losing balance, I'm losing everything. Yeah? And now you got your solution, or at least the answer of why your hip, knee, ankle, or lower back hurts when you're walking. Yeah? Because as opposed to keeping a relatively decent position and put together, you're introducing movement somewhere else than it's supposed to be. Yeah? In easy walking, the motion is happening between the rest of the body and the ankle. I'm falling over my toes. Everything else stays relatively in the same position. Now, if anything in the process of moving forward falls back, it's going to result in conflict, yeah? Because part of me wants to go forward, part of me wants to go backwards, creates the motion that messes up with the system, yeah? So again, it could be back, knee, ankle, foot, plantar fasciitis, whatever you want to call it, spinal stenosis. All those different diagnosis things fall into the same mechanical pattern. Either I'm holding it together as I'm falling forward, or I'm losing it apart, yeah? It's much easier to hold the balance, the stick on the finger, than hold three sticks, one on top of each other, yeah? So how many sticks do I have when I'm moving forward throughout the gait? If my head moves at different rate, if my chest moves at different rate, if my lower abdomen moves at different rate, how many things do I wiggle out of place? Well, you can point out pretty much from the side view where the problem is gonna show up. Okay, so as opposed to using gravity to help me and keep it joyful and go forever, now I'm using my body to try to plow through it, move it over, do different things, and reorganize it, yeah? So it's just a question of, can I strip back, can I look at it and say, okay, maybe that's not the best way to move, yeah? Maybe I can change something, and I'll keep asking questions. That is, what is it that you're trying to change? Yeah? If the joints are hurting, is there anything you can do to minimize the load on the joints? If for some reason you feel like you're too weak, is there anything that you can make it stronger? Yeah? If you're not feeling secure, if you don't feel like you're trusting it, what is it that you can do to make it better? Make sense? So what I'm trying to do is make it so you go home and you have more questions than answers from this lecture. Okay? I don't want you to be the person that comes into me and says, solve my problem, because I don't know what your problem is. I want you to come tell me, this is my problem. I figure A, Y, X, Y, and Z, and it doesn't work. Can you help me? Then we can work, yeah? Because otherwise, you go to the doctor, they do the X-ray, oh, your knee is bad, let's replace it. Well, good for you. You still don't know how to walk on it, yeah? And then I have to start training you back after the surgery to start with, well, these are the things you need to pick it up before you can use that new knee better, yeah? So new knee or old knee doesn't matter if you're still using it wrong. If the knee is the only obstacle to hold you back, theoretically, you should wake up after surgery and start walking. Well, that ain't the case. I had only one like that, yeah? 2 days after surgery, the guy climbed up two-story ladder to clean up the gutter and beg his doctor to do the other knee. That's the only one time in 24 years I've been doing this, okay? Normally, it's a 3 months of how many things do I have to go through and why did I do it before it feels good, okay? So as you're looking at it, identify what the problem really is, okay? So again, if we go back to exercises, and again, definition of exercise. So you can do aerobic exercise. So that's where the running, swimming for cardiac health goes in. There's a strength exercise where you're doing some weights and other things. And there is some balance exercises. There's Tai Chi, Pilates, whatever you want to call it, yeah? This is not the time to group it and say, this is better, this is worse. The idea here is, you choose whatever you want, but figure out why you're doing this, yeah? Check your body, figure out which one goes to it, try something, and see if it makes it better at the end of the session, yeah? You go for half an hour to exercise, what did you achieve in that half an hour of exercise? Do you come home joyful and happy? Or you just say, what the hell did I do? I'm sore, I can't move, everything hurts, I missed my perfect show on TV, my friends are calling me, I can't answer the question. Yeah, so the idea here is be joyful. Yeah? If you're putting your life on pause, that's not joyful. Yeah? Joyful is you're feeling happy. So I look at different people who are having different perspective on exercise, and there's a very tiny book that came into my hands. It's written by Danny Dreyer. He wrote two books that are basically identical, and he made money on the same thing twice. Smart idea. So he did chi running and chi walking. Yeah, so the guy is ultra marathoner, so crazy dude running over 50 miles. Yeah, so 100 milers and 50 milers and different things. And he decided at one point in his life, he's already the best that he can be, but he started getting older. So what would be the better way to achieve efficiency at what he does, which is running? And he decided, he lives in San Francisco, see people doing Tai Chi. Why don't I take Tai Chi and figure out why they doing this? Yeah. So he took Tai Chi and decided to take elements of Tai Chi and apply it to running. So he did this for running and for walking. And he basically talks through the whole book. It's a probably for slow reader, 2-hour read. Talks about how much more efficiency can you introduce by talking about exactly the same elements. Stability, mobility, let it fall forward. What you can keep together, how can you focus on different muscle when you're doing what you're doing every day. Yeah? So that was one idea that kind of seemed to me very brilliant, because not only the guy spoke in a very easy language about what you can do about your everyday task, but also how can you be better at it. Yeah? So it's not doing more. It's not doing more mileage, more speed work, more drills, more nothing. No, it's about where you're connecting with your body and improving the form. And nobody teaches movement like that. Yeah? Even, like I said, even if you were through athletic program in school, they always tell, okay, here's your workout for today. You're going to swim this pool for 50 times, then you're going to change the style, you're going to be doing kicking, you're going to be doing this. Yeah? And then we see who's going to be winning, and you get your scholarship, and everybody else just whatever. Yeah? You go to football practice, okay, you're going to run this many times. If you get this much beating and you're still thinking straight, we're going to give you college football scholarship. Everybody else, good luck, check your brain later, but that's how it works. Yeah. So nobody tells you that you can do that motion better. They tell you do more of it. If you come up stronger, we're going to reward you for that. But remember, your life depends on your movement. Yeah. You are not military cadet that has to pass very intense scrutiny training, and if you survive it, you get your patch of honor and you're going to be Navy SEAL. Yeah? That's a selection process. Your exercise routine should not be based on selection tool. Yeah? And what we see is a lot of people are doing more and more intense workouts in attempt to get healthier, and they're forgetting most of those exercises are derivative of selective tool. Yeah? They are all stuck together to figure out who's the strongest in the room so we can trust them with going for whatever unknown territory and survive. Yeah? You cannot look at it as your healthy tool for life. Yeah? You got to scale it down. You got to pretty much dumb it down. Elements of it are good, but think about it. What is it that you do to your body? Yeah, is it good for you when you're doing certain exercise? The fact that you go to the gym every single day for the last 20 years and you do the same thing over and over for the last 20 years doesn't mean it makes you better. Yeah, because your body over 20 years has changed. The need for different exercise changes as we're aging, but you're still stuck with the same workout. Yeah, the best example of stuck is the runner. The runner is ultimately, to me, like a perfect example of the donkey. Stubborn like hell. Can go forever, but not the smartest one in the bunch. Yeah? We get people that run a lot, and they think that running more is going to get them better. Yeah? Yet every single article you read about how to be better at something goes back to, can you cross-train? Hello? Yeah. So how much more can I get quality into my working? Yeah. I was watching the marathon track. Some reason. There it is. So I was watching the marathon trials, and there was a guy, I don't remember his name, but the commentator said, this kid spent the last So there's this kid that is qualifying for marathon for the Olympics, yeah? and the commentator says, this kid for the last year spent more time on treadmill than anyone else that he knew. And the answer is, so when they ask him, why did you do this? Is it better training on the treadmill? I mean, if anybody tried to run on a treadmill for half an hour, you go nuts, yeah? And the answer is, this kid was aware that he's asymmetrical. He had an ankle or knee injury in the past, and he was favoring one leg. So the only way that he can focus on what he's doing was on the treadmill, because he can hear his footstep. So he could hear that there's asymmetry, and his goal was to improve in symmetry, in form, before he can introduce more mileage. Because you know, if you got poor form, you do more of the same thing. It's going to get worse. Asymmetry is one of those things that messes everything up. Yeah. So as you're looking at your balance, at your own walking, when you're correcting it, think about it. Okay, if I'm losing it, am I losing it equally on both sides? If I'm good at something, am I good on both sides? Yeah. How symmetrical is the body in performing things? So this is like a self-diagnosis tool. You can tell, oh, one side is worse, the other side is better. I can think about it. As I think about it, my body is engaging in a different way. So when you're going for your walk, whatever the length of your walk is, when you do your exercises, whatever exercise you do, can you change the way you think? Slow down the pace, lower down the weight, and let your body actually feel what happens when you're lifting the weight. Is the weight actually working in the body parts where you want it? Or is the weight breaking your body every single time you're trying to do it? Is your walking propelling you forward? Or is your walking breaking something in the process? How relaxed can you be as you do this? So you turn your activity into a mindful process. Yeah. So we're talking active aging. There's speakers in this series that are way better at talking probably in science than I am. But there is a constant referral to how to prevent Alzheimer, how to prevent the cognitive decline, yeah? So how can you achieve better mental acuity if you don't think, yeah? So let's go back in time, yeah? You go to elementary school when they're teaching you how to write and read. What is the first exercise that you are told to do? Grab a piece of pen, pencil and paper, and there's a letter A, and you run the whole line of letter A's. There's letter B, and you write the whole letter B. You do it until you get the shape, so you're consistently doing the same letters. You get the 20, whatever, 4, 26, depending on what alphabet you're in. And then they teach you how to stack it together so you can form the words. Then the words are forming sentences, and then you go to college or high school, and they ask you to put sentences in together so the essay comes out. Yeah. So what is it? Is it the exercise of how much pen can go on the paper and the ink changes the color? Or is it the exercise about how you're putting your thought process into some sort of form of essay? Yeah. When Tolstoy wrote The War and Peace, this wasn't about how much pages he can cover. There was a line and theme, and there's a message, and there's a lot of different things. Yeah. So why do we think about writing in different way than we think about other exercises? Yeah. It's a writing exercise. When you're talking about mathematics, solving problems in mathematics is the same thing. You're solving it in a logical way, so there is a solution to it. There is a thought process in it, and there is an outcome that's supposed to be measurable and agree to it, yeah? 2 + 2 = 5. Great, 5. Why? Yeah? So when you exercise, why did we strip that logic? Why do you see people standing on the treadmill watching TV or reading a book? What is it that you're trying to do? Yeah, your body is moving. Yeah, it's better than nothing. But if you're already wasting half an hour, at least get the full benefit from it. Feel your body. Can you do it better? Do less of it, but do it better. Yeah? And now you can talk about it, joy or no joy. Yeah? Don't do the same thing over and over, because then your brain is basically numbed down. Yeah? You don't have to think about it, so you don't get that cognitive process on solving it, how to do it. Now, if you're changing, yeah? So another guy that pops in my head, there's, I don't remember first name, but I think McDowell, he wrote the book titled Born to Run. So there's a lot of running stories in that book, but the main thing is the Indian tribe that runs bare feet in the mountains, and they seem to be doing fine, and there's no problem with them and no injuries, no other things, yeah? And this guy is going back and forth between the reasons why humans are such a good runners, yeah? One of the observations was when they did the study on comparing human gait with horse's gait, they realized the human gait is way more efficient than horses, yeah? Then there's another speculation. Humans actually developed a lot of cognitive skills based on the fact that we had to move and hunt and do different things, yeah? So he describes how in Africa you can actually hunt by running. So he goes with the guys that are actually original tribesmen in some place in Africa, and they show him how is this possible that the human can run gazelle to death, yeah? And he described the process. So you got three guys, there's a herd of gazelles, you pick which one you want for dinner, and then you're running after the same one. So now how do you run after the same one? They look alike. Well, you have to recognize which one is which, you have to recognize her footprint so you can separate from the herd, and you're chasing the same one over and over. Humans have way more endurance. They are not as fast at the short distance, but they can go forever because it's cheap, it's ergonomic. But how much cognition is required to keep chasing the same gazelle? You need to know which one it is. You need to find the food spit, and you need to recognize it, yeah? So he describes it in the process, and he says, anthropologically, this is one of the most stimulating to the brain activities, yeah? Because you have to do it, yeah? The proof that horses are slower than humans, there's a race in California from the Squaw Valley to Auburn called Western State 100, and originally, that was a horse race. Yeah, it was for the riders going on the horseback, and they were doing this over a certain period of time until the guy decided to join it. And 2 years later, I think the guys actually won against the horse. So they decided to separate it because it's an unfair game because humans were winning. Yeah. So, you know, you read those stories over and over, over and over. I run with the dog. I know how much faster and how much longer you can run than a dog. If you want the dog running at your pace, it's going to die sooner than you do, yeah? I got multiple stories of people that are actually killed their dogs by taking them for a marathon training, yeah? It is uncommon, yeah, because you let the dog off the leash, they go like crazy. But humans can go better and longer if you do it right, yeah? So going back to head involved in movement, yeah? If you can control your body, if you can keep changing how you're walking with focus on that goal of yours, you're going to get better benefit, yeah? So if I'm looking at my joy, I want to walk easier. I want to go lazier and more smooth and not waste my time and not hurt. So can I think about, am I using my movement from the knee, from the hip, from the back, from the shoulder, or am I just falling forward and I'm just catching up with the gravity? If I'm carrying something, is that weight breaking me down all the time? Am I fighting it all the time the other way? Or do I have enough power that my body still stays in the same position? I'm carrying it forward like I'm supposed to. Make sense? So those are the things that it's coming back to that self-awareness, self-observation. Yeah, you start seeing it better, you start feeling it better, then you can correct it. That is probably one of the speculations that you got people that go through, I don't know, professional football career, professional basketball career, and you got some people that go at the end, they retire at age 35, and they seem to be doing okay. And then there's guys the last 2-3 seasons, ACLs, shoulders replacement, tore up, barely walking at 40, yeah? We see more and more of those, but again, this is not the statement of probably human talent, it's more about training and what we demand from those people. But again, there is those historical figures that they can pick up movement easier, and there's people that don't seem to be catching it. There's people, no matter what you throw at them, they cannot dance. Yeah, dancing is just beyond my scope of talent. So again, if you dealt bad cards, don't feel bad about it, but you still have room for improvement. That's what I'm trying to say. You don't have to have talent for movement to move better. Now, if you do something about it. Get better at it. Don't just waste your time sitting and saying, hey, I'm moving pretty good, but last week my mileage is a quarter mile, and it's all combined between my car and my toilet, and that's it. Okay? Another recent study that I just read Somebody made an research looking at how likely can you get Alzheimer disease, and they linked it to how much walking do you do. And it came up that if you go on short from 10,000 steps a day, your likelihood of getting Alzheimer or cognitive decline is 65% less. So funny thing, because the Japanese, when they were selling the walking counting devices, they came up with you got to walk 10,000 steps so you can keep using your pedometer to measure it. And it was random sleeve out of the number. But then the study that just recently came in came really close to the same time, 10,000 steps. Yeah, the 10,000 steps, if you break it down on feet walking, that's coming up to about 3 miles, I think. Yeah, two and a half, 3 miles, depending on how fast, how long stride do you have. But 2.5 to 3 miles a day, that's a lot of walking. Yeah. Now, if you think about it, you live in a town like Sonoma and your car broke down, and you live in the city limits. Yeah. If you had to go one day to post office, the next day to Pete's to get your coffee, the next day to Safeway to grab your groceries, and every day you go somewhere, that 3 miles is going to be a breeze. And I'm just talking, you live in Sonoma City. Now, if you live in Temelec, by the time you get to Sonoma City, you already have 3 miles. Okay? So again, there is a little different load if you think about it. What is it that we're trying to do? Yeah, historically, nobody was exercising. Everybody was walking from place to place, and if you did it good, you lived longer. If you did it bad, you broke your leg and you were the village kind of hustle, yeah? And we created that environment where we have very little opportunity to actually move. And with not moving, and in addition on top of that, having a lifestyle that is relatively comfortable, we created a bigger set of problems than actually solutions, yeah? Our bodies are kind of falling apart faster than they should be. We're having diseases that nobody heard of 100 years ago. And we're dealing with things that we shouldn't be dealing based on the fact that society moved so far. Yeah? So how many things can we do to overcome those things or minimize the impact? Yeah? Learning about it is the first step. Yeah? If you don't know how you can fix the problem, or if you don't know that the problem exists, you're not going to be doing anything to fix it. Yeah, this is the part that I want everybody to have it. Yeah, no matter what your problem is, think about it, how bad that problem affects your life, and then identify what that problem is. What can be done to fix it? And don't come to me to solve it. Think about it. What did you do so far, the work that didn't work? What other people suggested to you to do this? And see how it worked. Yeah, what is the scope of intervention that is possible? Because there's things that are beyond repair. Yeah, the fact your driver's license was issued in the wrong year, that's not my problem. Call DMV. Yeah. But as you're going through life, is this really the only blame that you can put? Yeah, the year of birth shouldn't be defining your level of activity on any given moment. Yeah, you got 80 years old that still run, and we got 20 years old that can't walk every single day. Yeah, I got 13 patients in a day every half an hour, and I see 20 years old having more problems than 80 years old sometimes. Yeah. On average, it's the other way around, but that's not the rule. Yeah? It changes. So what do we do that messes us up so fast? Yeah? How many things can we do? So you had Allison speaking about diet, yeah, part of this series. Well, it's not easy to change habits. Yeah? If you grew up with mama's cooking and the only recipes you know are based on lard, good luck. But it takes an effort to change it. Yeah? You got to learn that this is possible. You can cook different things. Yeah. I always had the problem with eating because my diet was meat. Yeah, if you don't have a meat in the food, that means that food is not really sustainable. I was laughing at vegetarians because there's to me, there was no image past what was salad. How long can you go on salad? Yeah, and my wife talked me into, oh, let's buy this pre-packed meals that are vegetarian-based. Yeah? And I'm doing this for last year already. Seemed to be okay, I'm alive. I lost a little weight, but that's still, I'm standing. I'm not falling apart. And it seems to be working. Yeah? So there is something to it. But again, someone else thinks about doing it for me. If I was to go to the store and try to pick up everything that comes in that package, I would go nuts. But then your cognitive thing goes up. Yeah. So it's just a question where the trade is. Yeah. So these are the things that I want you to think about it. So mechanically speaking, I want you to be better. But you have to tell me, what is the better you want to be at? Yeah? You want to win gold medal in the Olympics? Okay, tell me, what discipline did you choose and what did you do to train for it? Yeah? If you just want to be better and you don't know what you're trying to be better at, not going to help. Okay? So it all starts with that body awareness. Yeah? How my body is moving. What am I doing that doesn't allow me to do this better? Can I do it better? Yeah, so before you complain about it, did you do everything in your power to fix it? Yeah? Some things, like I said, not fixable. Not easy to deal with certain things. Yeah? Another joke that we were looking at that keeps coming. Yeah? How generational health has changed. The example that keeps coming is how mobility of young generation has changed from the previous one. And apparently, till 1960s, U.S. Army manual taught that the most stable position to hold the weapon and shoot was a squat. And they stopped teaching that after 1965 or 1968, something like that. And the reason was, well, so did they came up with weapon that is better, or they came up with better position that is? No. The reason they stopped teaching is because most recruits couldn't go down the squat and stay there. Okay? So we're talking something huge has happened, and now we're going through with big changes, and nobody bothered to ask the question, why did this happen? Why is it that other nations in the world can sit, play cards, smoke cigars on the break from lunch and squat at position, and most white people cannot get down? Okay? Now, right now, that's pretty much, that's a bad statement. Most evolved countries cannot get down. Okay? Those ones that are supposed to be society, richer, higher, better living, and things like that. Yeah. So we're doing something to our bodies that is not good. And the question is, what in my life is holding me from doing better? Okay? If it's the part that I don't know how to do it, well, read something. You're part of this one. You're attending the series of lectures, people are telling you, you can move better, you can walk better, you can eat better, you can think better, prevent your Alzheimer. But how to do that? Yeah? Start with asking a question, what is it that you have a problem with? Are you weak? You don't know how to do it? Are you having problem to understand what you're trying to do? And then you get different people that can help you with it. Yeah? If you don't understand how this works, well, physical therapist can help you understand it. You go to trainer that is teaching you how to move, well, ask him a question. You pay him the money per hour. Tell him, okay, how about if we spend one session, as opposed to doing more repetition and more weight, you tell me, where should I feel it? How should I feel it when I do this? Yeah, so I can understand better what is going on with this exercise. Don't just do it by repetition more and more, because if you don't know what you're doing, it's going to fall apart. Yeah, we all taking movement very much for granted until it falls apart. And then we don't know how to fix it because there's nothing left to work with. Yeah, we strained all the compensatory mechanisms to the point where it's already too weak, and now something breaks in the system and everything is falling apart. Yeah. So this is the part where, you know, we can help people get better, but we need cooperation on every level. We need that understanding of what is it that we're trying to fix. The fact that I'm telling every single patient that comes to our clinic, squeeze your butt, no matter what your problem, is because probably you are in a bad position. No matter neck, shoulder, jaw pain, if you're not standing right, the other system has to pay for it. Yeah. So it's not because I have a fetish with the butt, it's because your butt is supposed to be responsible for 90% of your activity. Yeah. If you don't do it right, something else has to pick up the slack. Yeah? If you're not standing using your hip, something else is going to pay for it. You can shovel snow in a Tahoe house with teaspoon if it joys you, but you're not going to get to the car garage ever. Yeah? So this is the same thing with human body, with human posture. There is muscles that's supposed to be primary movers. There's muscles that's supposed to be helping. And there's a bunch of other muscles that's supposed to hold your body from collapsing. You don't need to know those muscles, but you can actually learn about it. Okay, is my body stable when I'm moving? Or is my body falling apart when I'm moving? Am I reaching to the shelf going in the same direction, or am I going backwards? As I'm walking, am I going in the same direction, or part of me goes sideways, the other part goes backwards? What's happening? Yeah? You have problem with it, we can bring it up to your attention. I love to pick up on everybody. Yeah, this is part of what we do as an evaluation. Yeah, what is the reason behind your problem? Is your reason the fact that you overdid it, you put something too heavy and it broke your weak system? Or is it the result of last 40 years of doing it wrong? And system finally say, you know what, I'm done. That's it. Okay? That is what makes it successful or not successful. Yeah? If your problem is one-time event, you fell off the ladder, broke your leg, probably chances of you returning back to normal is much higher than if you were limping for the last 20 years and you broke your leg. Yeah. If you wore out your joints because this is too much mileage from running on pavement and pounding it down without thinking, probably you're going to perk up for knee replacement much faster than someone who wasn't doing it at all and walked on bad knees and stiffness and whatnot as the same solution. Yeah, that's where you hear those stories on the first page cover. Oh, I hiked the Mount Whitney 2 weeks after my knee replacement. Yeah, never met that kind of patient, but you hear them. Yeah, there's periodically that cycle that happens on the front page of the newspaper, then they advertise, you go here, we'll fix your knee in 2 seconds. You go there, we'll fix your heart in 2 seconds, yeah? Well, yes, there is those stories that happens, but statistics says it takes you way longer to heal. And in the process of healing, you gotta fix the problem mechanically that caused you have the problem in the first place, okay? So much rather have to fix it before I go through traumatic event like surgery, or bring it up to your attention before you go for surgery, spend some time salvaging what you were given, and then work with what you have. Yeah, then you make your decision whether it's a good idea to go forward with this or this or this, change. Yeah, so that's where I stand. My life is much easier to work with something that is actually workable than trying to work with something that's completely fallen apart and we don't know where to start. So it's a selfish reason I'm here. I want everybody to be happy, healthy, and active, but once in a while we have to bring it back, okay, let's go down, let's figure out what is it really that makes you happy. Because it could be that what makes you suffer like crazy made you happy for the last 50 years. And now this is go to Jesus moment, you gotta stop, you gotta redefine what happiness is. Would you rather walk or would you rather run? Maybe you can run in water, on water, depending on how you feel, yeah? Maybe you can change how much you're running. Maybe you can change from running to walking and still enjoy the space and still enjoy the company. Maybe you don't have to lift those heavy weights in the gym. Maybe you can join the class with Pilates, or maybe you can do something easier. Maybe you do some stretching as opposed to it. You still your social fix on going to the gym, but you get different type of exercise because your body cannot sustain the same thing over and over. But that requires that moment of pausing, self-awareness, and figuring out, is this really when I'm happy? Yeah? Because if you're happy, don't start exercising right now. Forget it. Yeah? Life is going to take care of itself. It's just a question of how well. Yeah, the goal in here is to mix the life with everyday activity and change that activity so you don't have to carve out half an hour for, oh, this is my exercise time. Why don't you use the time when you go into your car to correct your walking? Why don't you use the time you're in the kitchen when you're pushing the vacuum cleaner to figure out, can I change this? Yeah? Every moment during the day, you can spare a fraction of a second and ask yourself a question, is this the best way I can do it? Yeah, you're standing in there, vacuuming, 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 and you're complaining to your friends, my shoulders are killing me. Okay, how about you change? Dance a little bit. Yeah, if your knee hurts after vacuum, maybe you can do a different thing. Maybe you can use your shoulder more. Yes, yeah? Change the strategy, mix and match. But you have to pause it for a second, ask yourself a question. Is this what makes me happy? Yeah, vacuuming, probably nobody makes it happy, but you can make it better. That's a bad example. Sorry for that. Yeah. So these are the things I want you to think about. When you go, you do your exercise. I'm assuming everybody in here does regimented exercise routine. Yeah. I'm assuming. If you don't, you ask yourself, why don't you? Yeah. And on the same note, maybe you don't have to. Maybe you live life to the fullest. Maybe you garden every single day for 3 hours, raking leaves and carrying them back and forth. Maybe you have a dog that walks with you for 45 minutes twice a day. Maybe you're doing something else that keeps you active and you don't need to add more exercise to your routine. Yeah? It's always the same thing. Sometimes people are coming and saying, whoa, I need more exercise. Why do you need more exercise? You're doing this, 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 and this. Yeah? Why do you need more exercise? Is this some sort of fixation, or are you trying to get something out of it? Yeah? And on the same, we got people that are doing relatively good in life. This is the last anecdotal example that I'm going to say, and hopefully that lady doesn't get offended. So she's 94. I know her for the last 2 years. She comes in and she says, Marek, I keep falling. My balance is bad. Yeah? So referral says balance, frequent falls. So I'm putting this lady through the test. Can you stand on one leg? Can you close your eyes? Can you move your hands? She's standing better than I am, 94. Yeah? I was like, what other test can I come up and find what's the problem for balance? Yeah? Nothing. She scores everything perfectly. She scored better than I did in my balance test. Yeah? So I started asking, so describe me the last time you've fallen. And she says, so you know I'm walking to my garden. And I carried two rose bushes in the pot. And I'm walking and I trip over the hose. Okay, so describe the last time you've fallen. So I was carrying folded laundry in a basket, and I forget I leave my slippers in the middle of the washroom, and I tripped over that. So that's twice in 1 week. Like, lady, you don't have a balance problem. You have a cognitive problem because you don't pay attention. Yeah? So do you need a caregiver to tell you to clean up after yourself, or you just need to pause it back and decide, okay, this is dangerous situation. I just need to slow down a little bit, and I'm going to live life to the fullest. Yeah. So those are the simple examples of kind of like, what is really my problem? Pause it for a second. I can't fix your balance because you're tripping on everything that I would trip. I would fall in the same position. There's no question. If I don't see where I'm walking and something is in the way that I didn't expect, I'm going to be falling. Yeah. I'm the perfect example. I impaled myself on one of the posts in the bike path. Yeah, this is the joke, but hey, 4 inches of intestine went away. So as we go through life, the graceful and hopefully successful aging should be about accepting what the changes are, but not giving up to them. Yeah. So the fact that you've turned 50 doesn't mean you have to stop running. But the fact that you turn 65 doesn't mean the Medicare tells you you cannot do X, Y, and Z. You can still do them, but you have to modify it so it doesn't hurt you more than you're already suffering. Make it so it makes you feel better. Change it a little bit. Modify it. And everything will be fine. I don't have anything else. So now the test will be, how do you supposed to walk home? Thank you very much.
That was great. I'm going to go ahead and get started while they're still collecting questions. The first one, I broke my right femur in February of 2021. I still have a mild limp. Is it too late to improve my gait?
I don't think it's ever too late to get better. Anything that we read as a science about betterment, all you need to do is just keep thinking about what holds you back. Yeah. So breaking a leg is a pretty traumatic thing. Chances are, if you're still limping, you probably didn't really fully recover what you were losing with fracture. So strength, maybe length of the leg, but most likely trusting that the leg is still there. That's the three things that we see consistently not being in place. So working on something doesn't mean you're going to be successful. So after traumatic things like breaking legs, some asymmetry is going to be always there. You may never be fully perfect, but giving up on working on getting better is probably the biggest mistakes that you can make. So and again, that's something that I see over and over. We get people for different reasons to physical therapy. We get them a little bit better or not, but then they were discharged. They don't do anything about what they were coming in for the first place, and then you see them a few months later, and they get worse. Yeah. So continue working on something is pretty much the only thing we get to get better. If you give up, that means you're pretty much going backwards.
I used to feel stiff after sitting through a two-hour movie. Now I feel stiff after sitting for 15 minutes. Any suggestions?
Well, choose shorter movies. But think about it from again, the perspective of how much body control do you have? So sitting just like any other activity requires you to pay attention. Now, if you go to the movie, or you're reading a book, or you're sewing, and you don't pay attention to your body is still exposed to gravity. The gravity is consistently squeezing you down. Now, the less attention you pay, the less fit you are, the more you compromise your position, the stiffness is going to be faster and faster coming in. Yeah, so it's the stiffness after sitting is nothing different. It's just the same problem coming earlier and earlier. Yeah. So if you're looking at it, bring your body awareness to what is better position you can sit, and then you get your solution. You can start actually training on sitting better. The fact that you're sitting doesn't mean that you should be relaxing everything and giving up on work. Yeah. Sitting by definition is probably one of the worst activities that we can do. It puts us in place where a lot of things are being strained. So relaxing in that position and spending a lot of time in it, it's comparable to new smoking, I think. That's the title that starts circulating. And sitting is your new smoking. It's the number one reason why we get in so much trouble. So change your sitting from passive to more dynamic. Use your legs to support your position as opposed to your spine. And you can get more out of that sitting. Yeah, but you have to be thoughtful about it. You got to keep changing something. So those are the things that could be done.
Arthritis in shoulder, had PT, which was not successful. PT informed me that she could not fix the arthritis. Only solution is to see an orthopedic doctor. What are your thoughts?
Who was the PT? No, so there's a limited amount of intervention you can deliver. Yeah. So arthritis, you have to look at it, what happens to your body. Anywhere when you have diagnosis of arthritis, well, your hinge is simply not working the way it was designed. Well, you can't open the door if the pin is out of the hinge, or if the hinge is bent, or if your door frame is not attached to the wall. Yeah, you're going to have more problems opening the door because the hinge is rusty. Yeah? So arthritis is very much an example of that rusty hinge. You can do three things with everything. Yeah? You can either suffer through it and keep plowing and doing something over and over. you can learn how to cope with the strategy. So you got arthritic change, you have to realize, okay, the shape of the joint is different than what it used to be. So can I scale down my expectation? Can I move in smaller range so I can still function and minimize the impact on my life that that problematic joint brings you? Or when you go to orthopedic surgeries, there is a way to go with it and try to do some modification fixes. That's where the injections are coming in, that's where the surgeries are coming in, and all the other things. That's the heavy guns on the other end of spectrum. Yeah. So again, physical therapy is not magic. We are not trained to fix your problem. We train to teach you how to deal with the problem. Okay, so that's the common misconception. I can't fix the fact that you're trying to operate round peg in a square hole. Yeah, those two are not compatible with each other. And arthritis, basically, that's what it is. You have a nice, easy joint when you dealt with it, but when it comes arthritis, it's defined by changing the shape of the joint. So if you're changing the shape of the joint, something is not working with the other part. Yeah, it's like trying to push something where it doesn't belong. Yeah, so these are the things. The only solutions are either learn how to unload it, move in slightly different way, or try to search pharmaceutical way of relieving your symptoms or surgery to make that hinge work better. Yeah. So these are the things that goes into it. Now, from my perspective, the fact that one person told you you can't do anything about it doesn't mean that that's totally true. Yeah. If you look at healthcare as the whole, there's a lot of different people in that healthcare system that could potentially affect the outcome of what you're doing. Yeah? Physical therapy is one of them. Arthritis is a complex problem. Yeah? It could be autoimmune system that triggers some sort of reaction, and it makes your symptoms go haywire. So maybe addressing diet, maybe addressing your hormonal imbalance, maybe doing something different can help it. And then there's a bunch of people that are dealing with more advanced tool in our body than I deal with. And maybe they can teach you that you can do better with coping with your strategies and problems. Make sense? This is that very much undermined portion of the healthcare that everybody's trying to defound, but it's the most important part in the whole human functioning. Yeah. So the space between ears should be more controlling the body. And it's proven that if you do a good job with it, you can decrease your pain level, you can live better with problems that you're dealing with. You don't have to have a perfect range of motion to be happy. Yeah? Usually people are complaining because it holds them back from doing things. Now, if it doesn't hinder your life, you don't have a problem. The fact that the arm doesn't move doesn't mean it's a problem. Yeah? It's how you look at it. So those are the things that I'm looking at in a lot of cases.
Two questions. Best position for sleep, body support of head, and does a good supportive shoe help?
The answer is it depends. If you like who you sleep with, you can sleep in any position. If you don't, you need more pillows. So in general, what you're looking like, so think about transition between fetal position and Homo erectus. Yeah, somewhere in between those two, there's a comfort position for everybody. Yeah, the more trouble you're in, the more you go towards the fetal position. And now there is more pillows required if you like this position and you're trying to sleep on your back. Yeah, you can do on your side, but if you lie down on your back, you need a lot of pillows to be comfortable if your body likes this position more. Yeah, the general rule is if you assume that your body is straight, your pillow should fill up the gap between where your head is and where the back of the chest is, and you should be okay. And it's the same thing lying down on your side. Yeah, if you're straight body, all you need is that much pillow to fill up the gap between your shoulder and your head. Now, the softer the mattress, you need smaller pillow. The harder the mattress, you need more pillow. So if you're looking through the room, how many of you in here, that's how many positions of choice there is. Yeah, so this person needs 10 pillows, this person needs zero. Depends. Yeah, I would need to see you and I need to figure out. Yeah, and the same goes for shoe. Shoe is not the ideal thing to start thinking about it. And again, comfort in shoe. What do you mean by comfort in a shoe? Do you need arch support? Do you need softer shoes? Do you need harder shoes? Depending on what your problem is, you got to go through a little more thoughtful process. So far, I keep going back and forth in the same thing. Nobody yet in human history was born with socks or shoes. So that means your foot is not braced for shoe. Shoe is just an accommodation. It's a trained behavior. So do I need to put more shoe, or do I need to take my shoe and walk without the shoe? And again, depends on the person. There's, on the market, you go to the store, and shoes are based on, okay, this is a leather shoe, this is a sneakers. But there is also more support, less support, more arch support, less arch support. This shoe twists my foot this way, this one this way. Supination, pronation in the foot, a lot of different things that goes in it. Now you can get the shoe with more heel, with no heel. Well, there were shoes in the 80s with negative heel, yeah? So there's shoe for everybody. It's just the question, does it really mean to you that it's more comfort? I notice people are going for more, and at the end of the day, they're actually losing what they could get out of the foot, yeah? But again, that's the individual assessment. Is that shoe really going to solve your problem? Some people just need orthotics, period, just like corrective glasses. You need them. It's just the question, what kind of orthotics do you wear? That is as important as going to the doctor to check your eyeglasses. Yeah, you can't just pick up the prescription glasses from off the shelf if you have two eyes in different directions and one eye is worse than the other. Yeah, they don't make them like that for everybody. Yeah, you have to go and get them made special. And the same with orthotics. Right. So it's again, the answer is it depends. Depends on who you are. Depends what your problem is.
Merrick, we tell people to stay active, but then I see former athletes needing joint replacements later in life. How can they train so they can avoid surgery in the future?
So again, are you asking the question about yourself or those athletes that are training? Yeah, because this is the more of a broad topic in terms of what is it that the goal from exercise is. Yeah, as physical therapist, my job is to primarily bring the most out of your body so you can last longer. As a coach, as an athlete, my goal is to bring the most out of my body so I can meet this gold medal at the next event. And, you know, growing up, there was a statement, through the science to tuberculosis, through sport to disability. So I went to Academy of Physical Education. That's the perfect example. You learn and you sport and you sacrifice in both ends. Yeah. So athletes are not necessarily healthy people. That's what you got to look at. Make sense? You're choosing to do something that you know it's going to be bad. Yeah. Well, I went to school over 20 years ago, and the first patient that I saw with dementia, advanced dementia, was a boxer. Yeah? And the doctor who introduced us to that patient says, too many hits in the head, and you got cheese for the head. Yeah? And that was 25 years ago, that was the first introduction. That's not a new statement. People knew that hitting the head is going to cause you a problem. They just didn't know why. And now all of a sudden, it's a revolution. You got concussion. Okay. Well, you knew that that's the problem when you sign up for it. That's why you're getting $5 million a month payment for doing this, yeah? But don't go and be surprised about it, yeah? Too much mileage on runners, sooner or later you reach the breaking point. You can't do it, yeah? Too many hours on a bicycle, cycling, something's going to give, yeah? So sport by any means is not health. Okay, so those are the two things that you got to look at it and you got to choose what you're trying to do. You either want to be healthy or you want to be athletic and achieve something. That's where I'm making a big distinction. I was never an athlete, never competitive athlete. I choose to be the guy that at 80 still goes for a run with the dog. Okay? I don't want to be the one who wins the gold medal. I just want to be the 81 who runs, even if it means to the corner and back.
This person is dealing with blindness and balance and working out. He or she competes nationally in Olympic track for disabled veterans. I'm not sure what the question is, but what do you think?
Again, if it makes you happy, go for it. Yeah, this is like I said, something brings you joy. That is not my place to comment.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. 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 Uh-huh. Yeah. So again, eyesight is number one tool that makes us keep the reference point with the rest of the world. Yeah. So if you're looking at simple example, why people get seasick is because the confusing information. Yeah. Your sight is moving and your boat is moving in different direction. Your horizon makes you spin. Yeah. You're losing your eyesight, so your information is more blurry. Your computer is messing up the information that comes out. Your balance as a function overall suffers. So as you're doing those things, yeah, it's a known phenomena, the other senses have to pick up. So your training of balance has to rely on other sensory input than your eyesight. You need to increase how much you're feeling your body parts in relationship to each other. You need to rely on the proprioceptive information from your body about joint position, muscle tension, everything else that goes with it, if you want to be at the level that you are and overcome the loss of one sense. Make sense? So that's the idea that, you know, you can't substitute that with better glasses. You have to substitute with other senses. So more practice makes those senses heightened. Yeah? I don't have a prescription. I would have to look at you and try to figure out where you are and what is it that you're doing to come up with solution. But every problem has a solution. If you don't practice those parts, you're not going to get better at it. Yeah. So again, question is, your body has changed. Did your training change? Make sense? How much do you need to increase balance work compared to other things so you can actually still deliver the same level of competitiveness? Yes, yeah? So you're not at risk of falling. Yeah. How much standing on unsteady surfaces? How much walking bare feet and standing on sponges and tilt boards and everything else do you use on regular basis? Yeah, those are the tools that will increase your sensation. Yeah, but again, there is a limited capacity on how far you go. Yeah, you're losing one sight, that's the disability. Question is how much you can compensate for. And that's, I don't know, without knowing what is it that you do, I can't tell you what you should do.
This question is about asymmetry. My iPhone shows asymmetry. Does the quality of the road service affect the asymmetry score on the phone? For example, broken pavement, moving to dirt side of road to avoid cars, etc. So it sounds like they have an app.
I don't get that question. I don't asymmetry.
Does someone want to clarify?
Okay, so is it that your phone is telling you they're doing something different with your legs as you're walking? That was the question? Because I think that's the part of the phone is telling you that you're walking differently with left leg and right leg as an outcome. That's how I understand that question. So again, if your phone is telling you one thing and you feel the other thing, why there is a message conflict? Yeah, and solution to it is not just stepping to the different side of the road, but trying to figure out why is the phone telling you that you're crooked? Yeah, so do you feel that you're doing something that is crooked? Yeah, because phones are based on probably some sort of gyroscope or whatever is in there that measures how much time you spend on one leg, how much time you spend on the other leg, and then they tell you that you're doing something different on left side, right side. Yeah, so if you're trying to fix it, identify the problem. Don't blame Apple for your problem. Figure out why is the Apple telling you that you have a problem. And again, that's how far I can go with it. Yeah, I don't know what that app is about, but that's...
Merrick, what do you think about Feldenkrais, and what do you think about chiropractic care?
Each one is the great thing. Depends what you're trying to do. Yeah, so Feldenkrais is nothing different than what I was talking about. Feldenkrais is making movement better. Yeah, chiropractic is about making movement better. They use different modalities, but it's the same thing. Yeah. you complementing different things. Yeah, chiropractor can teach you move better by doing something to you. Physical therapist can teach you moving better by doing something different to you. And Feldenkrais instructor is going to teach you how to do it better. Yeah, it's just movement type. Yeah, so if it suits your goals, go for it. Like I said, try it, see if it works. If it doesn't give you anything to what you are right now and doesn't make you better, don't pay for it. That's how it is. You ultimately, it's your money at the end of the day. If you don't feel better about it, don't do it.
This person works at a retirement community where they have walking groups. Only 3 of 80 participate. Any suggestions for encouragement?
So again, questions, why don't they? Yeah, because again, you can't convince someone to do something if they don't feel that it's going to be productive. I'm a perfect example. You don't tell me why, I'm not going to do it. That's how I've been all my life. If I don't understand why, if I don't feel like I need it, good luck. Yeah. So encouragement has to come with sense of purpose. Yeah. You need to understand why you need to do this. And telling someone to do something just because I said so is usually not working pretty good. It's a bad parenting model and seems to backfire at every age. As you get older, you kind of reverting. So telling I told you so, it's not a good approach, apparently.
Merrick, what was the name of the book you mentioned in the beginning of your presentation?
So there were 2 books. One is Qi Running and Qi Walking. So there's 2 books, but basically information is the same. So Danny Dreyer, I think it's D-R-E, like not like ice cream, but like Dreyer, I don't remember. It's a very cheap read and a very fun read because there's a lot of information, there's a lot of exercise in it, and it's all about that ease of motion. So again, from the perspective of someone who was already at the top of their game and they improved just because doing something different made them happier. And then the other book was, again, McDowell, and it was Born to Run. Celia? Yeah. Christopher McDowell, yeah. So it's again from the perspective of the guy who learned how to run at relatively late age. So he's the big guy that was convinced that running is good for you in his late 20s, early 30s. And then he started running longer and doing more fun with it. And it's a nice thing to kind of like have a good humor. You're laughing your butt off by reading that book. It's really nice. Nice book, and there's a lot of factual things in it that he quotes a lot of actual information, not anecdotal things. So it's a really cool book to read. Okay, again, from the perspective of the runner, it's a good thing. For most people, it might be kind of boring, but he actually goes into research and to doing legitimate reporting.
I had an ankle replacement 13 years ago and have a very tight Achilles tendon that results in severe, frequent tendonitis. What can I do?
Well, so again, ankle is part of the chain. Yeah, by replacing something that is perfect with something that is not perfect, because again, let's don't cheat. Replacement joints are not coming any close to what the original joint can do. Well, you have to increase mobility elsewhere. Yeah, you cannot rely on one joint to be good. Yeah. If you think about it, ankle replacement was result already of some sort of bad form and movement. Yeah, it created overuse that required replacement. So chances are the same mechanics is still staying in place. Yeah, so by correcting higher ups, maybe modifying what happens in the body to do it better, could free up some motion. Again, magic is not going to happen to the fullest, but giving up on working and looking for solution is the worst thing you can do at the point. Yeah. So tendonitis is an overuse of a tendon. Yeah. You can't rely on Achilles tendon to hold your whole body. It has to do it together with something else. Is there anything else that can pick up the slack? And again, is there anything else that can pick up that slack? That's without diagnosing somebody and without seeing what the true problem really is. Okay.
How does sitting too long impact the body?
Okay, so we've been through it. Yeah, sitting, new smoking, and the reason for it is you're losing the whole support system from your waist down. Just sitting down perfectly straight can triple the force compression on your spine. And that's pretty well documented. You can sit perfectly straight, and just going from standing to sitting, you can multiply the forces to squeeze your spine. Yeah? So the longer you stay in the same position, and the less you pay attention to that position, the more likely you're going to be squeezing your spine more and more. So everything that you can pretty much talk about suffers the longer you sit. So you're losing your ability to walk, you're squeezing the nerves in the spine, you're compressing the spine, so you get your stenosis, you got your arthritis in the spine, you got your disc degeneration in the spine, you got your hip arthritis, knee arthritis. Everything is a consequence of sitting too long. That's pretty much how straightforward you can go with it. Yeah? Your heart is going to suffer because you're sitting in a more compressed position. You're breathing shallower when you're sitting than when you're standing. So there's cascading effects on everything. It's just a question, is there a way to avoid it? Is there a way to modify that? So ergonomics is a relatively new concept. I mean, the word is old, but ergonomics at the workstation is relatively 80s invention. Yeah, and in Bay Area, there's actually a lady who actually brought that ergonomics to life in California. She was part of that movement that actually made OSHA and whatever stations working. And her name is Eileen Wolowitz. She lives in Novato. And she quoted the study. They did actually the experiment. Yeah, they designed perfect workstation based on your anthropometrics. They put you, college student, because whom do you measure? College student is the best material to measure. They put them in the cubicles, set them up in the work, set up the cameras, and measure how long will it take to start slouching. After 25 minutes, there was no one who was sitting straight. So it's not the ergonomics that fixes it. If you want the ergonomics tool, grab a piece of wood, chop it up, and sit on the edge of it. It's not going to be comfortable, but you're going to be paying attention. The softer it is, the more likely you're going to slouch. The more comfortably it's designed, the more likely you're going to slouch. As you're slouching, you're losing your defense mechanism. Your protection goes out the window. It's not going to be good. Car seats are a perfect example. Yeah? You look at 80s, you bought yourself a Cadillac, how was it? You sit in it as a couch, soft, easy, squishy. And then the Japanese came up. You get your butt in the Honda Civic, hard like a bench. Well, go to NASCAR and see how many drivers sit on the couches. They sit on a wooden bench because they have to pay attention. Every second, every fraction of a second counts. They don't have time to keep changing position. They have to sit on relatively not comfortable position so they pay attention. If you put somebody in a comfortable position, they fall asleep. The same thing happens to your muscles. Your muscles have to protect you. Yeah? And no matter how hard you try, 20 minutes, attention span goes out the window. Now, the more you involve in what you're doing, the less likely you're going to pay attention to your body. Good luck trying to be multitasking. Yeah? The more interesting the book, the sooner you're going to compress your back. That's how simple it is. Yeah? You sit on something that is not comfortable, you're going to be better than if you sit on something very comfortably and ergonomically designed. That's the message. No matter how old you are, no matter what your problem is, that's pretty much the truth. That's how far I would go with it. Now, there is way to make it better or worse, based on your anthropometrics, based on your shape of your body. But that's as far as you want to be good, scoot to the edge of the chair. Forget you have a backrest. Press your legs to the floor. How much of your head is controlled by your legs? How much can you relax your shoulders and still sit straight? Make sense? And you can't do it if your butt isn't working. You're going to fall off the chair. You just got them. How much more do I need to repeat it? You go to PT. So for those who never saw me in physical therapy, the message number one, you can do better. Number two, stop complaining. Number three, squeeze your butt. It depends on who you are. I'm going to change the sequence, but the message is always the same. And that's how I'm planning to retire, because human body doesn't change. You either don't pay attention, or you're complaining about it, don't doing anything about it. And the number one reason you're not doing it is because your major muscle doesn't work. Yeah? So wherever you are, use the bigger muscle, and you're going to be fine. It's just connected to what movement you're trying to do it. Do you need a handout?
When I see Merrick working with patients at the outpatient PT clinic, all I hear is, squeeze your butt. He's a funny guy. Mark, what do you think about PRP?
That's not my expertise. That's talk to the doctor. So PRP is the injecting, what is it, plasma-enriched proteins. So you take the... My understanding is you take the blood, you filtrate it somehow, and it comes back to you as a whatever with enriched stuff. So people injecting this to the joints, trying to salvage the joints. Well, there's a lot of studies saying injecting saline water to the joint makes you feel better. Injecting cortisone to the joint makes you feel better. Talk to the doctor. That's not my expertise. You do whatever you want to do. There is a reason, marginal, there's a reason why non-insurance is covering it. So get that message home before you spend
$2,000 to $3,000.
Home insurance is covering it, and usually if it's not effective, all those stem cells are a hype.
One more question, Mark. I broke my right femur February of 2021.
Did
I do that one?
Yeah.
Okay, that's it then. So we've got a big round of applause for Mark Grzybowski.
Thank you very much for wasting completely good hour and a half of your life on me. Hopefully it was productive in any way. Go home and ask questions. That's already successful.
Thank you, everyone, and we hope to see you back next week for Dr. Cao's presentation.